morning. It's so wonderful to see everybody out today. And I have to say, the sunshine is fantastic. And it reminds me that spring is coming in more ways than spring is coming. And so praise the Lord for all of his blessings. Would you rise and join with us in song?
Have a seat, and good morning. How great he is. Good morning to everybody. It's good to see you. I am telling you, it was chilly this morning. Somebody asked if I rode my motorcycles. I told my hands were too cold to put the chains on it. So if you're not picking up a bulletin, you're not getting some of the information, because we're not going to be repeating everything. So as you come in, there's in various places. Hey, we go through a lot of trouble to put this thing together. So, but it's a good information source. Also, if you're not on the phone tree, if you're not in a small group Bible study, if you're not in connection with people day in, day out, looking for ways and opportunities to connect with each other, with your church family, be doing it. This is a place where you can come. This is a safe place. This is a place of growth. This is a place for maturity in Christ. This is a place to show our love to each other and proclaim that we trust God in all things. If you'll read in the bulletin, there's one thing that's wrong. Friday night, family night, we will not have that this coming Friday. The following Friday, we're not having it either, but we're having a cleanup day here at the church on the 26th. So we're going to have breakfast, and then we're going to have a cleanup day, and we're going to just... You know when we scheduled our last cleanup day? April of 2020. Guess what? We didn't have it. Guess what? Things haven't left. So come. Look at some of the things. Find some of the things that are... We have some cool stuff here at this church also. It doesn't all just need to go to the dump. Some of it needs to be put into use. So come for that. And so there's also other things, this blood drive coming, associational deacon training, but just get a bulletin on your way out, grab one wherever. But I'm so glad to see you today. It is our honor to be able to worship with each other, to come together and to see how God is working in each other's lives, to hear praises, to hear petitions of how God can intercede in our lives and our needs. And so we come this morning to pray. We come this morning to lift our hands up to God, to encourage each other, but also to bring our petitions and our needs to Him. Stephanie? Okay. I'm sorry to hear that. Sure. Sure. But she has somebody to help her. She has somebody that will take care of her. That is such an answer to prayer right there, even so. But we're going to continue to pray for her, all your sisters as well, and for you. There's a lot of depression, but there's a lot of joy if you look for it. There's a lot of good things going on. Father, we thank you this morning that you are with us. You have not given us a spirit of discouragement. You've given us a spirit of encouragement to encourage ourselves and to encourage others. Father, we pray this morning for the physical needs that need to be met in our church body, our local church body. We also pray, God, for the international issues that are going on. We pray, God, for the brothers and sisters of faith in Ukraine and in Moldova and other areas that are that feel the pressure of war, the losses that we're seeing for families, for mothers, fathers, sisters and brothers, people that are losing loved ones. Father, there's evil in this world. There's no denying that. There's unbelievable horrors that go on in this world. But God, you have called your church to step up. You have called your church to be proactive. God, we see you at work day in, day out in the things that happen, but we also commit ourselves to pray, to fall face first in front of you, Father, and to ask you to be specially diligent for our sakes, to open our eyes, to open the eyes of our hearts, to see you at work, to show yourself powerful. Father, we come to you today to bend a knee. We come today to worship. We ascribe to you worship more than just coming to hear on church on Sunday mornings. We all week long, all our lives through, want to acknowledge you in all that we do, in the good, in the bad. Father, help us to encourage each other, but encourage us this morning. Open our eyes, open our hearts to see you at work. That's what we desire, Father, is to see you at work in our lives and the lives of others. And we worship you today in Christ. Amen.
Please stand in honor of reading from God's Word, Psalm 40, verses 4 to 13. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who does not look to the proud, to those who turn aside to false gods. Many, Lord my God, are the wonders you have done, the things you planned for us. None can to speak and tell of your deeds, there were too many to declare. Sacrifice and offering you do not desire, but my ears are opened. Burnt offerings and sin offerings you do not require. Then I said,
Here I am, I have come. It is written about me in the scroll, I desire to do your will, my God. Your law is within my heart. I proclaim your saving acts in the great assembly. I do not seal my lips, Lord, as you know. I do not hide your righteousness in my heart. I speak of your faithfulness and your saving help. I do not conceal your love and your faithfulness from the great assembly. Do not withhold your mercy from me, Lord. May your love and faithfulness always protect me. For troubles without number surround me. My sins have overtaken me, and I cannot see. They are more than the hairs of my head, and my heart fails within me. Be pleased to save me, Lord. Come quickly, Lord, to help me. Sing with us, Wonder.
God, your glory never falters. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for allowing us to be in your presence this morning, and we ask that these tithes and offerings bring honor and glory to you and to you only. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Reading from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 35, verses 3 through 6. Listen to these words concerning the promise of Jesus Christ. Strengthen the feeble hands, steady the knees that give way. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong, do not fear, your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution. He will come to save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer, and the mute tongue shout for joy. Water will gush forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. Please stand as we continue in worship.
Is it true?
There is a light that calls to talk.
There's places in the world today, this morning, where people are crying out to God. They're crying out to Him because of what's going on in their lives. They're crying out to Him because of what's going on in the lives of their loved ones. And in places, in dark corners, in lighted hospitals, in every place you can imagine, God is available. God is there. He's there through His omnipotence. He's everywhere. He's very powerful. He's omniscient. He's omnipresent. He's loving and caring. And then sometimes He allows you and I to participate. Sometimes He allows us to see what He's doing in the quietness, in the stillness. We prayed for Ukraine earlier. We pray for other places of darkness in the world that are going on right now. That God is there. God is present. And with the suffering, God is there. And God sends His church. God sends His children to be in those places, not of comfort, not of rest, not of refuge, but sometimes He sends us into the fire, and He stands with us in the fire. And He stands with those that need Him. God is a God of creation, of sustaining, of loving, of grace, and of mercy. And He's present. Let's pray. Father, we acknowledge who You are. You go far beyond what we can comprehend. You go far beyond what we can physically touch or see. God, You've created us. You've created us for a relationship. You love Your creation. You don't turn Your back on Your creation. Father, when things are difficult, You are present. When things are joy-filled, You have come. Father, we reach out for You today. Open our eyes, open our hearts. Let us hear a word from You. In Christ we pray. Amen. You know, I had friends that went with me one time to Mexico, a doctor, some doctors. One particular was a maxillofacial surgeon. And after they did the work in Mexico where we were at, we were near Guadalajara in a town called El Salto. He said, you know, we really didn't do anything. We really didn't save anybody. We really didn't find any kind of medical disaster going on or issue going on and help them. And I just said, your presence, you're touching these people who have never been touched by a real doctor in their lives. Your presence just there to help them. It means more than you could ever know. It has answered prayers for people that are just looking to know that God can supply, God can create an event, a situation where His children are present and available. And then He also is there in those amazing times when somebody needs to touch someone else. And so sometimes when you can't even tell that God's at work, but in some way, constantly God's at work in some way. And then there's other places where very blatant. And I told you, I think, about this gentleman that went with me, the maxillofacial surgeon. An Amish guy came in and got kicked in the face by a horse. And so he was going to rebuild his face. And he asked the wife, he said, give me a picture of him. She goes, we're Amish. We don't have pictures. He goes, well, give me a driver's license, something I can see. She goes, we don't have a driver's license. So he just rebuilt him. He just rebuilt. Can you imagine this doctor who was in Mexico saying, we've not put our hands on anybody. We've not seen anything. I saw a movement of God there. I saw people saying, God is blessing us by sending people here to us to help us, to encourage us, to show that He cares for us, even in these impoverished areas in Mexico. And then I think about this gentleman who surgically repaired people. And by the way, his wife said that he looked better after he had worked on him than before he started. I've told you that story before, but it's impactful to me because I see a surgeon who says, I've got to do something great. I've got to do something, you know, tangible. I've got to do something and see God at work. No, God is at work with us constantly in our joy, in our He's just constantly with us. He is a God of miracles. And whether we, you know, they say familiarity breeds contempt. Now, whether it breeds contempt or not, I don't know, but it sure breeds desensitization. When we know that we can go to a hospital and we can receive care, we can just run right over here to Watauga Medical Center and we can get life-saving care, and we know that is amazing. Amazing. We put it out of our minds how amazing that is. We've become desensitized to the fact that there's medical care. When we see our parents that are aging, when we see our friends that are dying, when we see comfort, we see aid lent to them. We don't set them out on an iceberg and kick it off and say, God bless you, have a good one. No, we have things that we can, and then we reach out to them. We touch them. And God says, through your prayers, He is present also. Now, God doesn't just always wait on you and I for our prayers. God goes before us. But what He does also in our prayers is He allows us to see Him at work. He allows us, you and I, to see His work in each and every one of us and those that we care for and that we love. I'm going to be in the book of Luke today, Luke chapter 4. I'm just going to read two verses. Luke chapter 4. Verses 40 and 41. Now remember last week we talked about Jesus who had come and he had entered the synagogue and he sat down and he said, the Spirit of God is upon me, has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to proclaim the release of the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, downtrodden, proclaim the favorable year of our Lord. And now we see it taking place. First he proclaims it. And now we see it. And while the sun was setting, all who had any sick with various diseases brought them to him, and laying his hands on every one of them, he was healing them. And demons also were coming out of many, crying and saying, you are the Son of God, and rebuking them. He would not allow them to speak because they knew him to be the Christ. He had proclaimed his mission. He was initiating his mission. He said, the blind will see, the downtrodden will be raised up, they will be exalted, they would... And right now, Christ is healing those. And it says, their friends were bringing them. And all those had friends. They were bringing them to Christ for him to heal them. And they were bringing others for demons to be released. And what we do is we see a picture of Christ here as the servant. He is the servant, the suffering servant of God. Now we see him as the servant. He is the servant that is coming to reverse the curse. He is the servant that is coming to see the people in need and to touch them. The physical attributes of God in his hands. Touching, healing, encouraging, driving out demonic oppression. Those that were downtrodden, he's releasing them. And we're seeing it taking place right here. This is Christ empowered to do God's will. This is Christ, the very nature of God, being a servant to his creation, showing his love, continuing to create and sustain, and like I said, reversing or sometimes suspending or accelerating. We see about when Christ made the wine in Cana, he accelerated that process. We see when people's hands were made whole again, he reversed what had happened and he backed it up. Christ is doing amazing, amazing things here. And it's the miracles that Christ is showing to these folks here is to show that God is on the move. To them, at that time, it was show God is on the move. It was the fact that he was showing miracles is showing that God is authoritative, that he has the authority, that Christ the Messiah. You know, in the Old Testament, it talks about that there's going to be signs and wonders. And if you think about it, every time God was on the move, there were signs and wonders. When Moses went to set the people free, when Abraham was in the wilderness, whenever, you know, different times, God showed himself on the move by signs, by wonders. And it was a very true thing about the Messiah. He was to come, and he was to be, first of all, he was supposed to be preceded by someone as Elijah to proclaim the year of the Lord, to proclaim the mountains laid low and the valleys filled in, to smooth the way, and that happened. And then Christ comes and he makes these proclamations, and then he comes to show, not just through words, but through actions of who he actually is, that he takes the natural and he does something supernatural. He takes the mundane and he does something unbelievable. They're looking for their Messiah. They're looking for the anointed one of God who has come to give them salvation. They were looking forward to those things. And a precedent to that was going to be signs and wonders. Christ comes doing signs and wonders. And so those that are looking for the Messiah have no excuse. The word goes out all across the land and saying these miracles are being done. They're bringing their people to him because it's of healings, because of signs, because of wonders, because of demonic oppression being released. He has the authority that has been talked about since Old Testament times, since the beginning of time, that the God of creation, the God of sustaining, the God of love and grace would be there for their people. And he has come, and he's showing them, and he's showing them signs and wonders. And so for those that are looking for the Messiah, he's present. For those that just are attracted, the Gentiles and the unbelieving Jews see these things going on, and they bring people to him. They want to come to the show also. I mean, it wasn't anything for Jesus to feed 5,000. Do you think every one of them believed who he was? No, they were coming from for the show, and a lot of people were saying, hey, show us this or show us that. You know, there's a lot more miracles that were done in Scripture that were not written down. But I'm going to tell you, in my opinion, God is doing a lot more miracles now even than what we had recorded here. Day in, day out, God is showing his authority. He's showing his attractiveness to us. He's showing his compassion, his true nature, truly who he is. You know, when I think about Ukraine, when I think about areas of warfare, when I think about what's going on in South Sudan, or when I think about what's going on in DR Congo, what I think about what's going on in the jungles in South America, or whatever, I think about miracles and wonders, signs and wonders. And signs and wonders in the Bible are just as negative sometimes as they are positive. Because it said that the demons themselves can use signs and wonders. We look in the Old Testament, and it said that when Moses would throw down his staff, they would do likewise. Their magicians would do things and all. I'm going to tell you what, that when God is at work, evil is at work. And when God is showing signs and wonders, they point to who he is, compassionate, loving, caring. But there's also signs and wonders that point to evil. Whenever I watch those multi-rocket missiles going off from Russians when they have the, I don't know exactly what they're called, but I see these weapons of war, and they can be used for good and they can be used for bad, but they're being used for bad. They're bombing children's facilities, maternity wards, schools, apartment dwellings, places of escape. We see signs and wonders. That's a miracle. Could you imagine in Roman times if they would have had a missile? I mean, they would wrap up a ball with oil cloth and then catapult it, light it on fire, and then catapult it at people, and it'd blow up, and they go, oh, you know. I mean, now with these missiles, with Stinger missiles, with other things, signs and wonders can be very negative. But they also point to who creates the negative. Points to evil. It's easy to see when God's at work and when God's stepping in, because wonderful, beautiful, majestic healing, fixing is going on, is taking place. That's who God is. And that's what Christ came to show, that his the Father came to show his devotion and son, in his unique Son, and empowered him to do the things that would call upon the messianic prophecies, that would call upon those who are blind and not seeing. At least it would show them something is at work here. It would call them and say that the something has power here to the good, and the devotion of the Father to the Son and the devotion of the Son to the creation was obvious. It also shows that Jesus has true life. True life. Because although Jesus the Messiah came and he was crucified and he was buried, he was also resurrected. As the Father gives life because life is in the Father, the Son gave life because life is in the Son. And he was not just resuscitated from the grave, he was resurrected. Because only God, who gives life, can take life away, allow it to ebb away. And only the God who gives life can give life. And Jesus showed the greatest miracle of all. and not just being resuscitated. You know, there's a lot of people that have the swoon theory, they call it. They said that Jesus was beat to a pulp. They said he was hardly recognizable as a man, that he was hung up on a cross and that he was crucified. And then the Roman guards came over there and they punctured his side, and water and blood came out showing that he had passed. They took him off the cross and they wrapped him in clothing and they put him in a grave. And then 3 days later, what happened? He arose. The one who was killed and had his life taken, he gladly gave it because he knew he could pick it up and come, not be resuscitated, not a swoon, not that they say that, oh, well, he was put in there and then after a while he kind of revived and went, oh, I'm actually okay. And no, this man who was beat beyond recognition would not have been able to stand in front of hundreds, would not have been walking on the road with others and say, do you not understand? This Christ that had life given to him by the Father as a human was also fully God, had life in him, and that's why he came to show us how a loving Father, a caring Father, not only has power over the nature that he created and designed and sustained, he also had power over the death that had separated us from him. And he came to show us that his death could be our life. He came to show us that no longer are we as Christ followers to be concerned about the sting of death. We're also not to hold on to life forever. You know, I pray for people. I do. I pray for people, but I know that at some point, life will not remain in us. This physical, this temporal life will not remain in us forever. Praise God. Because would you want to live here forever whenever we know that on the other side God has prepared for us a place that has no longer the things that separated us or divided us from him, the sickness, the illness, the death, the disappointment, the brokenheartedness, the evil that we see each and every day if we open up our eyes. That same God that has created that place for us has also created a way for us, a way of escape that we can endure what we're seeing here. But we have to be participants in what's going on here as well. And so even though our bodies disintegrate, and our bodies, once when we're young, we think we're bulletproof and we think that we'll go on forever, we, as we start getting older, start to recognize the fact that we will not. And that things just like the old Chevrolets I've only had, or Fords, or whatever, they start to give out. You can replace parts. I've had a few replaced parts, but eventually it plays out. But I thank God for that as well, because I want to go to be with him one day. And he told us in 2 Corinthians, I think this is beautiful, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm going to read verses 1 through 7. It says, For we know that if the earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For indeed, in this house we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven, inasmuch as we, having put it on, shall not be found naked, because we've got that life from heaven. For indeed, while we are in this tent, we groan, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but to be clothed, in order that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now he who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave to us the Spirit as a pledge. Therefore, being always of good courage and knowing that while we are at home in this body, we are absent from God, we walk by faith now, but we walk by faith, not by sight. So in other words, God has prepared a body for us whenever we pass. We're going to meet that body in there. It talks about it in Scripture. It talks about it also in 1 Corinthians 15. It talks about it here in 2 Corinthians 5, that we need to be thoughtful about that we are one day going to be separated from our body. And so we can continue to pray for our body to be healed. We can continue to pray for those around us, their bodies to be healed. But the fact of the matter is that one day we will be separated from this, and we should be taking that as glory. We should be taking that as a good thing. We should be saying that it's all right. But in the meantime, we need to open our eyes and see the miraculous things that God is doing in our lives. See that that God is true life, that He has reached out to us, that He, even in the negative things, as it says in Romans 8, works all things for His good. So when we suffer sometimes, and we're laying, we had a friend of ours, Emily French, and she had to go through a lot of treatments, chemo and everything, as she was on her way to leave this place, and she was dying, and she would go there and she would talk about Jesus to the people that she was taking chemo with around. Now let me tell you what, that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool when you know that you're walking, you're doing everything that her family wanted her to do, because she was walking her way towards salvation. She was walking her way towards a life of eternity with God, and to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. But as she was making that walk, she was telling everybody around her. She's going, "My God reigns. I'm doing the things that I can to sustain myself, but one day I won't. One day He'll allow me." Paul said that. He said, I'd rather go and be with Jesus, but it's better for you that I remain. And Paul suffered. And as Jesus' miracles were taking place, the disciples, He sent them out, and they were doing miraculous things. And as Paul was traveling around the world on his missionary journeys and all that, you see that he gets farther and farther. Every now and again, there's a miraculous thing that's recorded that Peter did, that John did, that others did, that they did in the Acts of the Apostles. We see, but they seem to diminish more and more as time goes on. And it's not because God's less strong. It's not because God's less powerful. It's not because God's less caring and He doesn't want to. If Jesus wanted to, like I said, we have recorded miracles of Jesus in the Bible. It wasn't a constant thing. Jesus didn't just walk down the road and people just fell over next to Him and when they were healed. No, He did it for a reason. He was doing it to show who He was. He was doing it to show it He had authority. He was showing it that He was an attractive thing, a compassionate God, that He had a devotion and a power from the Father, that He was able to. But slowly by slowly, this apostolic age started ending and miracles were less and less. And I'll tell you why. Because they became less overt and they became more personal, I believe. Even today, we have personal miracles going on day in, day out. I know people in here, I'm looking at you, that I have prayed for, and I've seen God do miraculous things in your life, emotionally, physically, spiritually, in your maturing process or whatever. I see it. I've felt it also as people pray for me. I know that my God reigns. I know that my God cares about me, and He is personal. But what He's trying to show me is, no longer, Daryl, am I just the healing God. I am Lord of all things. And as God interacts with you and I day in, day out, in such a miraculous way, that He would care for you and I, that you and I, who seldom put a lot of thought into God during the course of the week, who seldom reach out and bend the knee and say, "God, here's my petition, here's my plea. Hear me, O God. And act. Not my will, but Thine." In other words, show me Your will and let me understand that You work all things to Your glory and to Your good. And that no matter how I view things, how I see things, God, I know You're at work. And just because in my small little world, in my small little view, I don't see certain things taking place that I would like to see, God, in the big view, if I were to open my eyes, I would see You at work. I would see You at work in the underground church in China. I would see You at work in the hospitals in Ukraine. I would see You at work in the rice paddies in Thailand. I would see You at work in the cocaine fields in South America. I would see You at work trying to release the captives, to give sight to those that are blind, to release and exalt the downtrodden because they are busted up. And You said that's what You were going to do. And then He shows us that He's doing it. And then He calls you and I as His children. He says, "Participate in My will. Participate in My work." There's certain things that we cannot do. And when we hit a brick wall because we can't act, we need to be praying. When we hit a brick wall because there's not some place that we could be going to see Him at work, then we need to stop and assess, what can we do? Jesus said, you're always looking for a sign, and that's us. We always want to see God at work. Sometimes we don't want to do the work of God. We just want to see God at work. He said, you are, in Luke 11, verse 29, it says, the crowds were increasing. He began to say, this generation is a wicked generation. It seeks for a sign, and yet no sign will be given to it except for the sign of Jonah. All right, let's break that apart really quick. This generation, this multitude of folks, this multitude of contemporaries, all right? A generation can be a bunch of different things. The word genia is used in a lot of different ways. We get it, genealogy, we study. But the word here, genia, can also mean a specific group of people that are contemporary to each other. We are Christians in Boone, North Carolina. We are contemporary. This is kind of a generation. Those that are believers, and I'm not going to say everybody in here is believers. Those that are in here that are believers in Boone, North Carolina, visiting, being right here now at Greenway Baptist Church, we are a generation. We are a multitude of similarities, of contemporaries. Jesus was talking to a bunch of people who were watching the signs take place and go, man, give us some more. He's going, you people, you contemporary, you see these things going on, but you don't recognize it. You keep asking for more and more signs. The only sign I'm going to give you is one that you can't miss. And that I'm going to be killed. I'm going to be hung on a cross. I'm going to be put into a grave. But in 3 days, because that's the sign of Jonah. Jonah's in the whale's belly, or the big fish's belly for 3 days. That's the sign I'll give you. But you are a wicked generation, and you're just seeking for signs. If we continue to seek for signs, maybe we're not seeing all the things that are going on around us. Maybe we're not doing things either. Excuse me. Maybe the sign that we need to keep our eyes on is Jesus at move, on the move. Is Jesus on the move in our lives? Is Jesus on the move in people's lives around us, where we're comprehending it, where we're seeing it, where we're capable of understanding what he's doing? Is Jesus on the move? If Jesus isn't on the move, we're missing it in our lives, because he is. Jesus loves his creation. Jesus gave himself for his creation. He is not going to walk away from his creation. He will always be present with us. And it's miraculous that he is. It's miraculous that I can go to the doctor and I can say, but there's people in this world that cannot. There's people that I don't want to get graphic or anything like that, but we see pictures right now of what's going on in war-torn places in this world, and families with family members, they're having to dig them out by hand. Folks, that's heartbreaking. That's heartbreaking to know that evil is plying its will against God's creation. And he tells us to be attentive to what's going on. So when I see that, I pray. I pray for the broken. I pray for the torn up. I pray for the people that just need a touch from God. I pray for those that are trying to help others to be sustained. I pray for you. I pray for myself. During this time in our place of COVID, of whatever might be going on in our lives, I pray that God will give us clarity to see him at work and to know that he works all things to his good. And it is miraculous that he cares for his creation. And it's not so much overt anymore. Do I see people stretching out hands? Do I see people, you know, but I see it very personal. Because see, that's what God did. He came from a chosen people to prepare the way, and then he went to all people. And he said, no longer am I the God of the Jews alone. I am the God of all. And I'm a very personal God. And you know, we ask Jesus into our lives, when he offers for us to come to him, and we submit ourselves to him, and he enters in us. It's a very personal experience. And that's, I believe, how God works day in, day out, miraculously, personally. Overtly, we see medical things that are going on. We see rockets going up. We see advances in so many things. It's miraculous. I'm going to tell you what. We're seeing so many miraculous things, in my opinion, that God is saying, I'm on the move. I'm on the move. Just throughout history, you've always seen God do miraculous things very overtly to show that he's on the move. I got to be honest with you. I see things that are going on in technology and in various other things that are asymptotic. I mean, if you look at where we were, say, with computers, 1980, and where we are right now, it's not just a flat curve. I mean, it's not just a x, y equals mx plus b or whatever. It's an asymptotic curve. Things are going crazy. I mean, I don't even understand it. I didn't even understand my Commodore 128 back in 1983 or whatever. I don't understand it. But I see things going on that are absolutely amazing, miraculous. Advances in medicine, advances in transportation. I see it everywhere. And to me, whether God is going to be here next week or not, he's showing it. He's showing off. He's showing he's on the move. And most of the things that he's on the move about are wonderful. Wonderful. When computers work, when they don't, when nuclear fission works, when it doesn't, which shows the God of all creation that does amazing, amazing things, there's also an anti-Christian view too. There's also an anti-Christ at work that takes the beautiful and makes it negative. I like getting into a show, watching a show or something like that, and all of a sudden it just goes corrupt. It just turned your stomach. Because you go, the beautiful things that God has created, man will destroy. And we're being urged along by anti-Christianness, by evil. But what I want to encourage you is see the great things and the majestic things and the mighty things that God hath done. And how he takes those things and how technology is now in our hands, and we can reach out to those people that we know that are in besieged places, and we can encourage them and say, we're praying for you. And we want you to know that when God is at work, he's going to take all things, he's going to work it for his good. I don't know what's going to happen to you, but I do know this, that God cares. And we see technology, and we see medical advances, and I can send you Band-Aids. I can do stuff like that, but there's people on the field right there doing amazing and miraculous things, rebuilding bodies, saving people's lives. That's God at work. That's miraculous. And day in, day out, God wants us to see those things, and he wants us to reject the negative. Because if we don't reject the negative, we don't see it, if we're always looking for the good things from God and we don't acknowledge the bad things, let me tell you what, we're just like the people looking for a sign. We're looking for the good things. We don't worry about the bad things. We're looking for a sign, God. He said, you are a perverse and wicked generation. You're always just looking for a sign. There's plenty to be seen. Look, open your eyes. And that's what we pray. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Show me what I can do in order to be a participant in the goodness, in the miraculous that you're doing day in, day out. That you're taking the broken and you're healing them. You're opening the sight of the spiritual eyes of people every day. And they're coming to you and they're coming to know you. And they're saying that my life doesn't mean that much anymore. But my life in Christ means everything because it goes on forever. It's eternal. We look at people and they suffer through what's going on and economically or whatever in this world, and we say, but you have a hope because your hope is not in this body. It's an earthly body, and one of these days you'll shed it and you will be glad that you did, because then you will stand before the true creator, the true sustainer in that new magnificent body, not made with hands, but made by your Father who had designed it that way in the first place, and you will be filled and present with the Spirit. I long for those days. I look forward to those days. But until those days, we have work to do. And it's miraculous that God uses you and I, because we're messed up. We're messed up. And it's miraculous that God allows people to be helped by atheistic, atheistic, Gnostic people that don't care, but God says, that's all right. All this knowledge, all this information, all this creation, it's mine. And I'm going to use it for my good. But be on the lookout, because people will use it for their bad. Be on the lookout that people will corrupt, people will pervert. And when we do not acknowledge God in all that we do, and all that he does in our lives, that's miraculous. When we don't do that, we're not giving him the acclaim and the glory that he deserves. It's anti-Christian. It's anti-Christian. We need to acknowledge him in all things. We need to be looking to him in all things. We get discouraged from time to time because there's discouraging things that happen. We get discouraged, but look, our God reigns. We read the end. It gets rough, folks. I love to read John. I love to read Luke. I love to read Matthew. Jesus comes as a baby, and he's so cool, and he helps us out, and he does these miraculous things, makes wine out of water. Awesome. He does, you know, But he's also going to come as the messianic king. And we read about that in Revelation, that no longer are just the good things that we as Christ followers are going to be looking to and pointing to. They're going to actually become. But it's going to be very harsh getting there. And so as we look forward and see and anticipate the coming second advent of Christ, as we start to look for that, we need to realize that this is a dying world. And as we read in Revelation, it's going to get rough. As we read in other parts of the scripture, people had it rough. But the fact of the matter is, God has prepared a place for us. He calls us to go, tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Everywhere we can. There's plenty of hills here in Boone. You can go over any hill here and you can tell about God. You can repeat the things, the good things that he has done in you, the miraculous things that he has done inside of you. If he's not done anything miraculous inside of you, your eyes are not open. Hey, you're here. You're breathing, most of you. God is present and accounted for. He is not absent. Thank you, God. Thank you for the miraculous. Thank you for opening the eyes and releasing us from spiritual turpitude, from spiritual prison where we don't see things for what they are. But as Christ followers, brothers and sisters in Christ, we open our eyes, we see him at work. Then he encourages us to be participants. And then we start seeing, even in some bad things, our God reigns. He makes good out of all things. I want to be a participant in that. Father, thank you so much for your goodness. Thank you for coming for us, for providing a way for us. Thank you that the miracles that you produce every day are not hidden. They're so available to us if we just open our eyes. They are so tangible. If we just take the scales off our eyes, Father, let us see you clearly. God, we don't want to just see you clearly. We want to interact with you fully. God, we want to know that your grace and your mercy is not just poured out by you, but it comes through us, your servants. Just as you used your Son, Jesus Christ, your unique one, just as the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit work together, you've also included us and call us friends, and you've not hidden from us. You no longer keep secrets from us. You open us up, and you let us see you at work in the micro and in the macro. God, we see you at work, and you're walking us towards salvation, but each and every day you walk us into your works. Help us to see your works, to do your will. Help us to pray, God, day in, day out, thinking about others, not just ourselves. Help us to recognize the fact that this is temporal, it's not eternal, and that you have prepared a place for us. Thank you, God, for that. We pray these things only in Christ. Can we pray? Amen. Amen.
I believe in miracles, don't you? Let's stand together and sing our way home. This is Amazing Grace. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King. Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you will take my place, that you will bear my Jesus, I sing.
worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Making that thing sing, buddy. I trust and pray everybody will have a great week. And you know how we can improve our condition, how we can improve our situation is to be speaking to the Lord on a regular basis. Because our spiritual, our physical, our emotional, our tiredness, our blindness keeps us from interacting with the God of creation. I pray that everybody will take moments this week to acclaim God for who He is, to praise Him for what He's doing in your lives, to praise Him for what He's doing in the lives of others, and recognize how He wants to use you. God bless you all. Have a great week. I would love to talk to you. If I can explain anything, if I can, whatever I can do for you, holler at me. God bless you all. Guys, gals, thank you so much.